Hello and good afternoon. Can everybody hear me? Once at the back? Okay, cool. So over the course of next 30 minutes, we'll be getting an overview of the architecture of GlusterFS and the future directions for the project. I am Vijay Bellur. I work as a GlusterFS architect in Red Hat. So the agenda for today is basically four W's and a H. So we'll first take a look at why GlusterFS. Then we'll look into what is GlusterFS. Then comes the H, how does GlusterFS work? And we'll get into where GlusterFS is being used today. That completes the third W. And the fourth W would be when does feature foo appear in GlusterFS, basically the roadmap. And after that, I think we'll have a short Q&A session. So the first question, why GlusterFS? I think we have seen abundance of storage and file systems. So why would we want to unleash one more file system or a storage solution on the world? And along with its set of problems and challenges that it brings about. So to answer this, I think a pertinent question to ask ourselves would be, any guesses on the amount of data that's being generated on a daily basis? Some number.
1 gigabyte.
1 gigabyte, that's way too low. 10 petabyte is also on the lower side. OK, I think I'll answer that. So the amount of data that's being generated today or on a daily basis is about 2.5 plus exabytes, which is like 2,500 plus petabytes a day. So we've got a real problem on our hands, right? I mean, where do you store all this data? It's not on your proprietary traditional scale-up boxes. You're going to hit into limits of scale. And the second problem is that, I mean, you're not going to be able to afford a solution that can store 2.5 plus exabytes of data every day. So that was one of the primary factors for GlusterFS to come into being, basically to address the demands of ever-growing growth of unstructured data. And another interesting thing to note is that 90% of the storage data that we have today has been produced in the last 2 years. So if this continues, we are going to have an explosion of data, and there are no signs to say that this won't continue. We take more pictures on a daily basis. This session might be recorded. So all of this eventually needs to be stored somewhere, and that's where distributed storage solutions like GlusterFS plays a part. And other key aspect that GlusterFS brings about is commoditization of storage. Earlier, you would associate storage with traditional proprietary vendors. You couldn't store a lot of data on your x86 boxes. GlusterFS, Ceph, and a bunch of solutions have been breaking this market and been trying to do or been trying to commoditize this market. So you can just hook up a bunch of servers, x86 servers, and store data on them. So commoditization is happening in the market as we speak today. And the other important aspect for us developers is democratization. So we are not just anymore bound to work on closed proprietary solutions if you want to work on a storage feature. So if you want to work on a cool feature like deduplication or distributed storage, you can do it on your laptops. So this is democratization of storage, and I think it's a good thing for all of us. So before I get into what is GlusterFS, how many of you are familiar with GlusterFS? Okay, that's a few hands. So GlusterFS is a scale-out distributed storage system. It aggregates storage exports from various servers or various devices over the network and provides a unified namespace that can be consumed by clients. So what GlusterFS does is, let's say that you have 10 storage servers, each having about 100 TB worth of storage attached to them. GlusterFS basically bundles all this together and provides you a 10 into 100, which is basically a 1,000 terabyte or a 1 petabyte consumable namespace. So basically, your applications can continue to write data to this namespace without getting into problems of running out of space on a particular server. So this is what GlusterFS does. GlusterFS is layered on disk file systems that support extended attributes, which means most of the disk file systems that we have today can be layered below GlusterFS. And Gluster provides file, object, and block interfaces for data access. We will be looking into that later. So now let's get into the H part of the talk. So how does GlusterFS work? So this is how a typical GlusterFS deployment looks like. So if you were to go bottom up, so this is the storage layer. You have a bunch of servers with various classes of storage devices attached to them. It could be DAS or direct attached storage, or it could just be a bunch of disks or LUNs coming from a SAN. And on top of it, you have the network interconnect, which could be Gigi, 10 Gigi, or InfiniBand RDMA. And data that is present and in all of these disks is aggregated by GlusterFS and presented upwards to clients. And clients can access Gluster through a variety of access protocols. So we'll be seeing that later in this presentation. So let's look at some of the architectural foundations for GlusterFS. GlusterFS is software only. It's not bound to any specific hardware. So it can run on commodity hardware. It can run on this laptop. One of the differentiators as far as Gluster is concerned with from other distributed file systems is that it does not have an external metadata server. Typically, in distributed file systems, you need a metadata server to locate where your data is present. So you might have thousands of nodes across which your distributed file system spans. And if you want to locate where exactly data is present, the traditional approach has been to do a lookup on a metadata server and then get the location of the data and then perform data access. But GlusterFS does away with the notion of metadata servers. So both data and metadata are co-located in Gluster. As I explained before, Gluster provides scale out, and this is elastic in nature. You can basically grow your GlusterFS storage, shrink your storage based on demand. The implementation is quite extensible and modular. We'll be looking into that later. And GlusterFS is deployment agnostic. You need not run GlusterFS only on on bare metal servers. You can run it in the cloud or in virtual machines, and it just functions. Now let's look at some basic concepts and algorithms that drive Gluster. The first concept that I would like to talk about is what in Gluster parlance is referred to as trusted storage pool. A trusted storage pool is nothing but a collection of servers, or this is the cluster on which GlusterFS operates. So this is the collection of storage servers, and the way you go about building this trusted storage pool is by something referred to as probing in GlusterFS parlance. Probing is nothing but adding a new server to GlusterFS. So the first, at the top, you can see a probe that has gone on to node 2. And after the probe has been accepted, node 1 and node 2 become peers in a trusted storage pool. So let's say that you want to decommission a server after a certain point of time. You can easily do that by performing a detach operation, which is nothing but the converse of the probe operation. So a probe and detach are the two primitives based on which you can grow or shrink your trusted storage pool or cluster. The next concept that would be relevant for our discussion ahead is something known as a brick. Brick is a basic unit of storage for Gluster. Brick is usually the combination of a node and a export directory on the node. So for example, a hostname slash dir would be a brick. So what Gluster does is it aggregates storage that's provided by all such exports. So, and that happens in something known as a volume. So volume is a collection of bricks. You could have as many bricks as you need for your capacity. And volumes are typically identified by an administrator-provided name. And volume is usually that you mount on the client to access data that's stored in a cluster. Yeah, so this is just an illustration of how volumes would look like. So you have three nodes in a cluster. And let's say that you have six bricks. The first three bricks could form a volume called music. And the second set of three bricks could form a volume called videos. GlusterFS supports several volume types. The volume type actually determines where data gets placed in a cluster and how it gets placed. For example, if you want to have three copies of each file or object that you create, that is tied to the volume definition. So you could say that in this volume, every data object that I need that I create has to be replicated twice, has to be replicated thrice. So there are various policies that you can apply. We will start seeing how some key volume types function. The first of which is something known as a distributed volume. What this volume type does is it basically distributes files across bricks of the volume. As of today, directories are present on all bricks that make up the volume, and files get sharded or split into these directories. So for example, if you have 100,000 directories and 10 bricks, you might end up with 10,000 files on each brick under that corresponding directory. So the distributed volume is the one which removes the necessity for having an external metadata server to locate and place data in Gluster. So what we use is a distributed hash algorithm. It's called the Davis-Meyer hash. And that is used to actually perform a hash on a file name to determine where a file needs to be placed. We will see how it gets done here. So let's say that we are creating a new directory called app1. And what happens is that, and let's assume that we have four nodes that form a volume. When this directory gets created, the directory gets created on all nodes, and a 32-bit hash range gets sliced by the number of storage nodes. In this case, it's, or by the number of bricks. In this case, it's four. So this particular brick would get 25% of the overall hash space. And so the second storage node would get the next 25% and so on and so forth. So yeah, you can actually now see here that, I mean, all the four nodes have about 25% of the hash space assigned to them. And when we try to create a new file called info.txt, the Davis-Meyer hash gets applied on the file name, and that results in a hash, say, let's say, 1, 3, 2, 3, 6, 7, blah, blah, blah. And you can actually see that that hash maps to this particular range. And that's how GlusterFS goes about placing the file info.txt here. When info.txt needs to be retrieved again, the client performs a hash on the file name again. The same value gets generated, and the client would know that a file is located here. Hence, it directly reaches the brick that contains the file. So this removes the necessity to have an external metadata server for looking up where objects are present in a cluster. Not quite. I mean, we have a nice implementation where basically, let's say that your info.txt got renamed to foo.txt, and let's say that hash maps here. So we don't actually end up moving the entire file from here to here. What we just do is we just create a pointer here saying that this file is present in this brick and it's not in the hashed brick. So that way, clients will end up reaching the object in two hops instead of a single hop. Right, so as more files get added, I mean, they get distributed to various nodes in the cluster. So yes, I mean, you have this distributed volume, but as I mentioned earlier, as you've been telling earlier, GlusterFS works on commodity hardware, and failures with commodity hardware and disks are quite common. Let's say that this node were to go down. It means that in a distributed volume, this part of your data or this subset of your data does not become, is not accessible anymore. Yes, please. Can you repeat the question, please?
When we add node, we need to
yes, that is performed by an operation called rebalancing. So it actually assigns a new hash layout and migrates data that might be necessary. And all of this happens online.
But migration is automatic.
Migration of files is not automatic, but it's driven by an administrative-driven action. The administrative action is referred to as rebalancing cluster. Right, as I said, a failure of a node can cause some part of your data to be not available. And to overcome that, you have something known as a replicated volume, which provides high availability for data. And basically, it works by synchronously replicating all updates that happen on a cluster volume. The updates or the synchronous replication is transaction driven. To ensure consistency, if multiple clients are writing, we wouldn't want one client to clobber the data of others. So that's why it's transaction-driven. Gluster maintains change logs for reconciliation. So we have a replicated data set. And let's say that one of the nodes is temporarily offline for whatever reason. Once it comes back online again, you need to replay data. And that is done by looking up the change logs which are maintained for reconciliation or syncing. And you can configure any number of replicas. So this is how a replicated volume looks like. When you create a file, it ends up being on both nodes. And through the transaction that's described here. Basically, let's say that client one tries to update file one. So it goes through this five-phase transaction. Basically, the first step would be to hold a lock on the file on all the servers, and you get back an acknowledgement. And once you get the lock, you update change logs saying that I'm going to update this file. Then you actually perform the operation here. And after the operation is performed, you update the change logs again to indicate where all this particular operation succeeded. And once that's done, we unlock the file. Till that point, if another client is attempting to update the same region of the file, it gets blocked. And once this unlock happens, the client gets the lock, and it goes about the same transactional mechanism to update data. So we saw replication, but again, in this picture, you actually see that there are only two copies. Supposing you have 100 servers, how do you cannot end up having 100 copies. So what do we do to utilize all the storage that's available on these 100 servers and provide availability as well? We have something known as a distributed replicated volume, which means that your data can spread out across a bunch of nodes and have high availability for data as well. So as you can see here, file one is actually placed on two nodes of a four-node cluster, and file two is placed on two nodes of a four-node cluster. We've also added erasure coding support in Gluster since 3.6, and this volume type is referred to as the disperse volume. It basically does RAID-5 like behavior over the network. So files get chunked, and they get placed on various bricks that form the volume. For performing this encoding, we make use of the Reed-Solomon algorithm. And this particular erasure coding implementation is referred to is a non-systematic one, which means that all nodes are treated as identical. And all of this encoding, decoding happens on the client side. All right, so now we saw all these volumes, and you can actually create and store data on these volumes. But how do you access data that's stored in a cluster volume? We have a bunch of mechanisms to access data that's there in a cluster volume. So these are the key access mechanisms that we have in Gluster today. The first one is the native protocol, which is fuse-based and which is most commonly used in deployments today. We also have NFS v3, SMB, and API-based access. This is Gluster's own API, and it's referred to as libgf API. You can access files also as objects through RESTful interfaces. We also have support for the HDFS APIs, and there is also experimental support for iSCSI through TGTD. Let's quickly walk through how each of these access mechanisms work. So with the fuse-based access, clients directly reach out to servers where files are placed. You can see that when an update to file 1 is being performed, clients reach out to server 1 and server 2 where file 1 is supposed to be replicated and update data there. And the retrieval also works in a similar fashion. So this is the API-based access that we have for Gluster. LibGF API is a set of APIs that are modeled after the familiar file system interfaces, like read, write, open, and the likes. And LibGF API would be running in your application's context. Basically, you would need to modify your application's code to talk to Gluster through LibGF API. The advantage of this is that with Fuse, you have additional context switches and copying of data between user space and kernel space. That gets avoided. So if you're looking at slightly better performance for your applications, you could make use of LibGF API. Gluster also has a native NFS v3 server. All volumes that get created in Gluster are exposed through NFS v3. And as you can see here, with NFS v3, all operations are server-side. I mean, with Fuse, all operations were happening from the client. The replication, the hash computation to identify the location would happen on the client. But with NFS, all of that happens on the server. So the native NFS server is nothing but a translation between the NFS protocols and the GlusterFS protocols. So NFS clients talk to the native NFS server through the NFS protocol, and the NFS server translates NFS to GlusterFS and talks to various bricks that form a cluster volume. In the last 18 months, we've also been integrating with NFS Ganesha, which is at another user space NFS server being in the community, and IBM, Panasis, and we are the chief contributors to NFS Ganesha as of today. NFS Ganesha has a very modular architecture. So we have implemented something called as an abstract FSAL cluster, which is nothing, FSAL stands for File System Abstraction Layer. And that talks LibGF API to GlusterFS volumes. And with this, we've been supporting NFS v3 access to Gluster using Ganesha. V4 is in the future, so I'll be talking about that later. Right, and similarly, Samba works or talks to Gluster through LibGF API. So we've added a plugin for the VFS plugin layer of Samba, and Samba also talks LibGF API to GlusterFS. Gluster also supports an object view of files that are stored in a volume. Basically, you can access files that have been created through a NFS or GlusterFS mount through REST or the vice versa. You can create an object through RESTful interfaces and access that as a file through NFS or Gluster mount. I mean, this is useful in cases where you want to upload a picture through the object interface and perform post-processing using standard POSIX-like tools that work only on NFS or POSIX-like mounts. This has been done by integrating with OpenStack's Swift API and a project called Swift on File. So Gluster, Swift on File is again configurable, and GlusterFS happens to be one of the backends for Swift on File. GlusterFS also has APIs that can replace the HDFS APIs and basically act as the underlying file system for analytics jobs that can run on Hadoop. In this case, you can look at, so you have the job tracker and various task trackers, and task trackers running on the storage nodes talk to Gluster through the API interface. As I mentioned earlier, there's also a experimental block or iSCSI access to Gluster. This is done through TGTD, and that's also been integrated with JF API to access data that's stored in a GlusterFS volume. So apart from this, we'll quickly look at other features that Gluster provides. So we have key features that are necessary for scale-out NAS, like elasticity, directory, and volume quotas. We have the ability to perform volume and file snapshots, which are necessary for protecting your data and backing up your data. There's also georeplication, which is basically asynchronous replication across geographies for disaster recovery. For the archival use case, we have support for worm, which is basically write once, read many times. There are a bunch of features. I think I'll skip this. Yeah, and for provisioning, we have Puppet Cluster, which does a whole bunch of things. James Shubin, the person who did Puppet Cluster, is right here. Yeah, and you have a talk on Puppet Cluster sometime, right? Okay. Right. Gluster is not just command line driven. We have integrated with oVirt for GUI and REST-based access for management. So this is a screenshot of the oVirt integration. We've also integrated with Nagios for monitoring. I don't think the picture is very clear, but basically you can get a whole bunch of alerts about problems that happen in a cluster, and you can be alerted about various statuses through the Nagios alerting. Now let's get into how it's implemented. Everything in GlusterFS is implemented as a translator. So if you look at this picture, so this is nothing but an aggregation or a bundle of translators that work together to perform a particular functionality. Each translator is nothing but a shared library. So if you want to extend functionality for GlusterFS, all you would do is throw in a new shared library and stack that together to expose that particular behavior. In this case, if you look at it, you can see a bunch of performance-related shared libraries or translators. If you really don't need that for your use case, you can actually remove them from the stack. So this way, it's extremely modular. You can visualize the translator stack as a set of Lego blocks put together. So that way, it's pretty cool. Yeah, so if you want to develop with GlusterFS, you can write your own translator, which is nothing but writing your own shared library, which adheres to a set of interfaces. You can write your own custom application using libjf API, and you could even talk to Gluster through REST APIs. So where does GlusterFS get used? So this is from the 2014 GlusterFS user survey. So if you look at it, mostly Gluster is getting used today for file sync and share and in virtual infrastructure environments, which is basically storage of VM images and the likes. Web content delivery is also a large enough use case for us. It's also used as a backup tier for archival and things like that. So if you look at the various set of projects that Gluster has been integrated with, on the virtualization side, we've integrated with OpenStack, oVirt, KEMU, CloudStack. For big data analytics, we've integrated with Hadoop and Tachyon. File sync and share, I mean, there's an integration with OneCloud, and there are a whole bunch of other projects which I haven't mentioned here. So the OpenStack integration for Gluster with the Juno release of OpenStack looks something like this. We have deployments where Cinder Glance and Swift data get stored on a GlusterFS volume. And Manila is a new project that's coming up in OpenStack and attempts to provide shared file system as a service. So we've also integrated with that. I'll be talking about that a bit later. So we come to the last W, which is probably more interesting. So when and what in GlusterFS next releases? Right. So these are some of the new features that we have targeted in GlusterFS 3.7. You would have support for tiering of data within a Gluster volume, the ability to detect bit rot, the ability to shard. I think I'll just go over these features here. So data tiering in 3.7 is basically about policy-based data movement across hot and cold tiers. So you could say that out of these 10 bricks, 5 are SSDs and they constitute the hot tier, and the other 5 disks could be regular SATA disks, and hence they form the cold tier. And Gluster can move data across these tiers by various policies that could be configured. And there's a new translator that we've added for identifying candidates that need to be promoted and demoted. And this is how the overall architecture would look like. So you have a hot tier, a cold tier, and the CTR translator basically identifies what subset of data needs to be present where. And based on that, promotion and demotion happens within a Gluster volume. We also will be adding bitrot detection support in 3.7. Bitrot is nothing but corruption of data at rest due to bit flips or your hard drives going bad. And this is done by associating a checksum with each file that's present in a Gluster volume. And the checksum is verified through regular scrubbing activities. And detection can also happen upon access of data. Sharding is a new feature that's targeted for 3.7. Basically, what happens over time in a Gluster volume is that you have a tendency to get fragmented and that have fragmentation problems. So there could be smaller disk space availability than the data set that you want to create. But you could have n number of such things over a volume. And sharding tries to address that by chunking and placing data in any node that has space available. It's typically suited for large file workloads. Netgroups and exports for the native NFS. This was basically some work done by the folks over at Facebook who use Gluster internally for whatever use case. And we took those patches from them, and we've been able to forward port it to 3.7. And this will probably get merged for 3.7. NFS Ganesha support will be enhanced in 3.7. As Rick was mentioning, we'll be adding support for NFS v4 and v4.1 to access data that's there in Gluster volumes. And probably a little after 3.7, we would also be adding PNFS support to access data that's present in a Gluster volume. So there have been several modifications to Gluster to achieve this. We're also looking at providing high availability for NFS Ganesha using Pacemaker and CoroSync. We've also been looking at a bunch of small file performance enhancements in 3.7. The EPOL, or basically the thread, or the network listener was single-threaded, and that used to be a bottleneck in a few cases. We've overcome that by making it multi-threaded. We also plan to add more in-memory caching of frequently accessed stat and extended attribute data on the bricks. So tiering will also help in improving performance. So let's quickly look at a few features beyond GlusterFS 3.7. So we are looking at hyperconvergence with oVirt. Hyperconvergence is nothing but breaking the barrier between virtualization on storage or compute and storage. Basically, you don't need two clusters for virtualization and storage. You can have a single cluster that provides both virtualization and storage, and we are looking to do that with oVirt. OpenStack Manila has been seeing a lot of action from us, and we'll continue to do that. We've added a native driver that supports multi-tenancy. This makes use of the fuse-based protocol to share data across tenants in OpenStack. And we've also been working on this, which basically provides the ability for tenants to access data through NFS and NFS Ganesha in OpenStack. The next big thing in the Gluster community is GlusterFS 4.0. So if you can see, the Gluster ant is present only in the middle. That shows the amount of work that has happened in relation to the scope of the project. I mean, GlusterFS 4.0 is a big thing, and it's not an evolutionary release. I mean, all of the features that I just described are evolutionary features in the 3.x release train, but 4.0 is going to be a big bang release with a lot of new cool things. Most of the things that we are attempting to do in 4.0 is for massive scalability and manageability. This has been based on the learnings that we have got with the project over the last few years. We expect 4.0 to enable much larger deployments and throw open a wide variety of use cases for us. Some of the key features in 4.0 include a new form of replication, improved distribution, and better caching, tiering, and a lot more. New style replication is something that works like this. I mean, it's basically does replication entirely on the server instead of it being on the client side as of today. This will provide more consistency with replication and avoid pitfalls like split brains that can happen in a distributed system. Or DHT V2, or this is the improved distribution, which lays a foundation for GlusterFS to scale to thousands of nodes. And as we improve the data paths, manageability also has to be improved, and 1,000 node GlusterD is an effort to improve is to scale the manageability aspect of GlusterD. So we probably will be making use of a Paxos Raft based implementation for membership and configuration management. So what's next for 4.0? So we're looking at a code name for the release. If you have a cool name that you want to associate with GlusterFS 4.0, please let us know, so it's still open. Not just the name, I mean, you can even propose features for 4.0, and that is also open right now. Implementation of a few key features has started, and we'll also be voting on feature proposals during a design summit. I mean, that's tentatively planned for March or April of this year. So as far as the next releases go, 3.7 is going to happen in April 2015. A few enhancements beyond 3.7 plus will happen between April 2015 and 4.0. And 4.0 is right now slotted for mid-2016. So if you want to learn more about Gluster, I mean, here are mailing lists and the URL to gluster.org. And thank you for listening. And if you have any feedback for me or on the session, I mean, you can use this URL to provide the session. So I think I may have time for couple of questions. Yes, please.
You mentioned like in the scenario when there is a replicated volume.
Right.
So we imagine that the response.
Exactly. If different clients see, so I think the question is, how does a split brain occur in a cluster volume? Right. So basically, if different clients end up seeing different servers, or if they have different visibility, that's when a split brain occurs. And we are looking at various mechanisms to overcome that. Some features would also be driven into 3.7. I think I'll just take one last question. I'm running out of time. And yes, please.
Is there any plan for support CTDB for NFS in future?
Yes, we do make use of CTDB for high availability with NFS and Samba as of today.
Yeah, because I can see in your presentation that there will be HA based on Corosint
right.
in the future. So it will be changed to this or?
So we would support both flavors, CTDB and Corosync and Pacemaker.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the HA story today, it's exclusively with CTDB. In the next release, we'd also be adding support for Corosync and Pacemaker.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
All right, thanks again. And if you have more questions, I'll be around in DevConf. Thanks.
I have some questions.
Sure.
First of all, I didn't clearly understand what is going on when you see split brain situation.
Right.
Both sides.
Right.
Disconnects from client. For example, we have two parts. One part.
Yeah, I can quickly draw that. Okay. So let's say you have client one here and client two here.
Yes.
And server one here and server two here.
Yeah.
Let's say these are replicated servers, and you have file foo here. Let's say that this is the normal state. Right, and this happens, this client sees only this one, it actually ends up updating this file if you don't configure anything. And this client, if it does not see this part, it actually ends up updating this file.
So the file became different?
It becomes different. The contents are no longer in sync, and that's when a split brain happens. To overcome that, we have support for Quorum. Oops.
I said no sign.